In this video, I'll walk you through all the settings and share all my tricks to capture a long exposure hyperlapse with a drone. Most drones today have an automatic hyperlapse function, but if you want full control and higher quality, manual mode is the way to go. It's more challenging, but that's what I enjoy the most. The idea here is to expose each frame as long as possible to get those nice long light streaks from the cars. The main challenge is that the drone is constantly moving, so things can get blurry rather quickly. To add to it, the shot that you see on the controller is not the shot that's being captured. So you need to make sure that all your settings are set correctly before the drone takes off. Before I walk you through each step, let me talk quickly about the legal and safety side of doing this. As a licensed drone pilot, I only do work within the FAA rules, but most importantly, always with safety in mind. So make sure you get all the proper authorizations before you take off. When doing long exposure photography, you cannot use a flashing beacon. The extra light will bleed into the image, so I am restricted to fly no later than 30 minutes after sunset. I try to give myself just over an hour to get set up and complete two takes of the hyperlapse, so I normally start 30 minutes prior to sunset. Step 1. Camera settings. In order to have full control and for better results, this is done using manual still photography, not video mode. The challenge is to figure out how long you can keep the shutter open while the drone is moving and still get a clean, sharp image. The truth is, you'll get some blur, but only on any objects that are close to the drone, and that's totally okay. It will look like a natural motion blur. I have found that a 3-second exposure works best, but in this example, I set my shutter speed to 5 seconds. I can get some really nice light streaks and keep most of the image sharp. When working with long exposure, what you see in your viewfinder or on your controller is not what you're capturing. The controller is just showing you a preview at 30 frames per second, so it doesn't have the ability to actually process each of those images in order to show you the actual results. So we need to test our settings multiple times before we send the drone on its way. Because we want a long exposure, I'll set my shutter speed first. In this case, 5 seconds. I now need to compensate for all the extra light coming in to the sensor. So I'll set my aperture to f6 and I'll adjust it once the drone is up in the air. Now keep in mind that once the drone goes up and faces the city lights, our exposure is going to change anyway. After adjusting my exposure, I'll take a quick shot and bring the drone back down to take a look at the actual image. If possible, I like to look at it on my laptop just to make sure everything looks good. You can see that after multiple test shots, I settle for an ISO of 200 and an aperture of 6.3. If your aperture cannot be adjusted, you can also use ND filters. You also need to think about the change in lighting conditions. It normally takes the drone about 20 minutes to complete the hyperlapse, so I normally try to overexpose the shot slightly, knowing that by the end of the hyperlapse, the sky will be much darker. The white balance on my drone is set to 56K, since I normally film outside during the day. But city lights are normally more around 40K, so make sure you adjust your white balance or your final results will be very orange. Now we need to set up our camera to take pictures in intervals. Depending on the file format you want to use, your drone will have some limitation as far as how quickly it can take the next shot. On mine, when shooting in RAW, the camera can only take a shot every 10 seconds. In JPEG, the camera can take a shot every 2 seconds. The camera will also need time between shots to write all the data. So let's say you're setting your shutter speed to, let's say, 3 seconds. You'll need to set your interval to 5 seconds to give the camera enough time. With a shutter of 5 seconds, like I use, the minimum interval is 7 seconds in JPEG and 10 seconds in RAW. Step 2, drone settings. The key here is to set a path using waypoints, for example, for the drone to follow, but to set the speed to its minimum. We want as little movement as possible while the sensor is exposed, just to limit the amount of blur. The distance traveled will determine how long it will take for the drone to complete the move, but also how many pictures will be taken and how long your end clips will be. The shot of the Ferris wheel in Seattle was a little tricky because when setting waypoints, you fly the drone at the starting point, record the waypoint, fly the drone at the end point, and set the end point. but you actually don't know exactly how the drone will behave and what the move is going to look like until the drone does it. So I often set the speed to be very fast and let the drone fly the path just so I can see if that's what I want. For Seattle, I believe I had to set 3 waypoints to force the drone to kind of curve around the Ferris wheel and not fly straight to the endpoint. If you use a third-party app like Litchi, you can program your path in advance and really adjust every aspect of the flight. But in my case, I normally just use the DJI app. Once you've tested the path, bring the drone back, set the speed back to the lowest setting, and do one more test. This time, taking a few images while the drone is traveling at the set speed. Bring it back and check the images again to make sure that your exposure is still good, but most importantly, to check the blur level. If you have too much blur in your image, you need to go back to adjusting your exposure at a faster shutter speed. Once you're happy with the test shot, check the battery level on the drone to make sure it can complete the mission and come back. Now you can just push the go button and send the drone on its way. I try to give myself enough time for 2 takes. I will check a few images after the drone comes back and make some adjustment and send it again. Step 3, post-production. Once you've captured all your shots, it's time to bring them into an editing software. Now I like to use Lightroom to edit the images. I will work on one image, and when I'm happy with the results, I can copy and paste the settings to all the images and then export them all in JPEG. Now we can create the video. Before importing the images to your editing software, you need to set the still frame duration to 1 frame. In Adobe Premiere, go to Preferences. Under Timeline, change the still image default duration to frames and set it to 1. In DaVinci, go to Preferences, User, Editing, and change the standard still duration to 1 frame. Now you can import all your images into your project. What I normally do is deselect them all and reselect them from the first image to the last so that when I drag them to the timeline, they will stay in the correct order. Now you can see your Hyperlapse for the very first time, and hopefully you did it right and all this work resulted in a great shot. I normally embed my Hyperlapse timeline on a new timeline so I can apply effect or make any adjustment without having to apply those settings to each individual image. Sometimes I also speed up the clip just to make sure it's not too long. And that's it. With a little patience, attention to detail, and practice, you'll be able to create stunning hyperlapses. I hope this guide has helped you get started. If you have any questions, drop them in the comments below. Thank you for watching this video until the end. And as a token of my appreciation, I'd like to offer you my free camera setting cheat sheet. Just follow the link below to download my free cheat sheet. Thanks again, and happy filming.